The weather couldn't be better. We have a brilliant sun at this moment, and here comes the president now. In fact, he's not in his limousine. He's departed the limousine, and he is walking. He is reaching across the fence, shaking hands with many of the people who have come here to see him. He is closely accompanied by Dallas police officers and, of course, the Secret Service. He is now shaking hands, and they are walking along the line of the fence, shaking hands with some of the hundreds of people who have come here to view their arrival. And now, the President and First Lady are retreating from the fence. They're heading now for the official limousine, where Governor Connolly stands, waiting their arrival so that they can make their way downtown and out to the trade mart. But this was one of those impromptu moments for which President Kennedy is so well known. So many times you have heard that the Secret Service men suddenly find themselves without the president, that suddenly he has left them and stepped into the crowd, the milling throng, and decided to shake hands and give his personal greetings. And this, once again, he did. Limousine, blue and gray, pulling away now from the fenced area. The President and Mrs. Kennedy seated on the back seat, Governor and Mrs. Connolly on the second seats or jump seats, and then the official driver and Secret Service men are in the front seat. A flying wedge of some one dozen Dallas police motorcycles leading the way, and the pace is picking up as they head for the departure gate and the trip downtown to the trade mart. Now, those of you who are waiting along the parade route, just to be sure that you find yourself in the proper location, let's give it to you once again. It will go Mockingbird Lane to Lemon Avenue, then travel south on Lemon to Turtle Creek, Cedar Springs, through the downtown area on Harwood to Main, west on Main to Houston, through the Triple Underpass to Stemmons Freeway, then on to the Trade Mart.
After greeting the friendly crowds at Love Field, the President took his seat in the rear of the Lincoln limousine next to his wife, Jackie, and right behind Governor Connolly, who was in a jump seat. The motorcade rode through Dallas, heading for the downtown area. The crowds grew thicker and were very friendly, as many as 12 to 15 deep. presidential limousine is turning right from Harwood Street onto Main Street and will head west for about 3/4 of a mile toward Dealey Plaza. Onto Houston Street, heading for the corner of Elm Street, and the crowds are just beginning to thin out.
President's car is now turning onto Elm Street, and it will be only a matter of minutes before he arrives at the trademark. I was on Simmons Freeway earlier, and even the freeway was jam-packed with spectators waiting their chance to see the president as he made his way toward the trade mart.
People running up the hill.
alongside Elm Street, there by the Simmons Freeway. Several police officers are rushing up the hill at this time. Stand by. Just a moment, please. Something has happened in the motorcade route. Stand by, please. Parkland Hospital, there has been a shooting. Parkland Hospital has been advised to stand by for a severe gunshot wound. I repeat, a shooting in the motorcade in the downtown area. Parkland Hospital has been advised to stand by for a severe gunshot wound. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. We understand Governor and Mrs. Connolly are in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody's been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong. I'm in behind the motorcade, trying to follow them. It looks as though they're going to Parkland Hospital. We're on the road to Parkland at this time. The Secret Service man is still spread eagle over whoever is in the car, the President and Mrs. Kennedy, and as we understand, Governor and Mrs. Connolly. At this point, it looks as though it could have been one or two or even all of the people within the car may have been the victims, may have been struck by shots. We don't know. Parkland Hospital in the distance, now on Harry Hines Boulevard, following behind the motorcade. They're approaching the entrance now to Parkland Hospital, traveling at a high rate of speed. I'm pulling in now toward Parkland Hospital, coming to the approach. An officer waving me down. He's waving me around. There's a cordon. There's already a cordon of police officers running from their cars, from their vehicles here. The official party, as I can see it, pulling around toward the emergency room.
The President of the United States is dead. I have just talked to Father Oscar Hubert of the Holy Trinity Catholic Church. He and another priest tell me that the pair of men have just administered the last rites of the Catholic Church to President Kennedy. I asked the father, is Mr. Kennedy dead? And his quote, he's dead all right. And just a few seconds ago, I talked to Thurman Ward, the Justice of the Peace of Garland. He's now here at the hospital to apparently officially declare that the chief executive of the United States has expired. President Kennedy has been assassinated. It's official now. The president is dead. Women here in shock, some fainted. Grown men, Secret Service men standing by the emergency room, tears streaming down their face. There's only one word to describe the picture here, and that's grief, and much of it. It's official. As of just a few moments ago, the President of the United States is dead.
John F. Kennedy died at approximately 1 o'clock Central Standard Time today here in Dallas. He died of a gunshot wound in the brain. Dr. Berkman told me it's a simple matter, Tom, of a bullet right through the head.
Just a few minutes ago, the President of the United States turned from Houston Street onto Elm Street on his way to a scheduled luncheon appearance at the Stemmons Trademark. And as he went by the Texas School Book Depository, headed for the Triple Underpass, there were three loud, reverberating explosions. Nobody moved. Everyone seemed stunned. A few seemed to look around, wondering who has the firecrackers. Then suddenly, the Secret Service men sprang into action. The convertible bearing the President and Mrs. Kennedy sped away, and officers, both plainclothes and uniformed, seemed to spring from everywhere at once, guns drawn, ordering people to lie flat. There are two witnesses who were near the President's car at the time of the explosions who say that shots were fired. From which upper window, we do not know. We do not and cannot confirm the reports at this time that the President has been shot. One witness says he definitely was shot, that he was hit twice, that he saw the President slump in his seat. As I say, this is not confirmed at this time. From where I am, the police have two witnesses. They are bringing them in now. I'm in the Texas School Book Depository building. They're bringing some witnesses in now. We will try to learn further and relay word to this station.
Mobile News Unit number 4 here at the Texas School Book Depository, where the area being completely roped off by Dallas police, the K-9 units here at the scene. I don't know what for, but a fire truck is standing by. Most of the officers, literally hundreds of them, armed with sawed-off shotguns, pump shotguns, automatic shotguns, and submachine guns.
I happen to be about 15 feet away from the president when the first shot hit him. The first shot rang out, and I was positive when I saw the look on his face and saw him grab his chest and saw the reaction of his wife that he had been shot.
Dallas motorcycle officers who were ranging along beside the cavalcade took off across the field in the direction from which the murderer apparently had fired. One officer raced to the foot of the nearby railroad embankment and climbed to the tracks above, gun in hand.
And you say, of course, that the motorcade speeded up immediately and rushed to a
doctor. And disappeared under the underpass, and I had jumped out by that time and was running with the police. They thought the assailant had fled over some railroad tracks. And they came through what they thought was the assailant, through several trains, standing on the tracks, and I went with them, and therefore didn't see the president immediately as he went under the underpass.
Well, did they apprehend this person they were
dating? No, they apprehended nobody at that time. They went back and started talking to witnesses on the scene.
I see.
I grabbed a couple of eyewitnesses to it and brought them back to the studio, and all of the policemen who were around where the building where he was shot were running back toward the railroad tracks, back behind, trying to find out who it was. Complete bedlam there at the site.
I went to the south side of Elm Street to look for any signs of any bullet striking the curb or the street or anything. By this time it had been established that the president had been shot. And Deputy Sheriff Buddy Walters joined me at that time. Everybody was coming to the scene of the shooting, which is normal, you know. People are just that way. But as I was searching the south curb of Elm Street, I heard a shrill whistle. And I looked up. It just drew my attention. It was coming from across the street. And there was a light green Rambler station wagon driving real slow west on Elm Street, and the driver was leaning over to his right, looking up at a man running down the grass. So I immediately tried to cross the street to take these two people into custody for question. Just, you know, everybody else was coming to the scene. These were the only two people leaving. And this was suspicious in my mind, you know, at the time. So I wanted to talk to them. But I couldn't get across the street because the city officer who was stationed at Houston and Elm had left his post, and the traffic, you know, was so heavy I just couldn't get across the street to him. But I did get a good look at the man coming down the grassy knoll. And he got in the station wagon and they drove west on Elm Street. It had been determined that the shots came from the southeast window. How, I don't know. The Dallas police were saying this, so we immediately went there. And Deputy Sheriff Luke Mooney was with me when we found the shells. We found three holes beside the window on the sixth floor. And they were laying three in a row, not more than an inch.
This was brass, so three spent cartridges.
Three spent cartridges. They were lying three in a row, not more than an inch apart, all pointing in the same direction. Of course, I didn't touch them. They hadn't been photographed or fingerprinted or anything. I didn't touch those. And there was a lunch sack, very small, brown paper lunch sack up there. Had some chicken bones in it. And there was a soda bottle sitting on a box. And we began then to search for a weapon. And we started toward, everybody took a different direction. And Deputy Sheriff Boone and myself just happened to head for the northwest corner building. And Boone was ahead of me by about 8 feet. And there were a stack of boxes just at the head of the stairwell going downstairs. And Boone looked over into it and said, "Here it is. Here's the rifle." So I immediately went over beside him and looked over, and there was a rifle. But we didn't touch it until Captain Fritz and Lieutenant Day from the ID department of the Dallas Police Department got there. Now, Captain Fritz was chief of homicide, and Lieutenant Day was from the Identification Bureau. They got there and took some pictures of the rifle. And then I believe Day pulled the rifle out and handed it to Captain Fritz, who held it up by the, had a strap on it. He held it up by the strap and asked if anyone knew what kind of rifle it was. Well, by this time, Deputy Constable Seymour Weitzman had joined us. And Weitzman was a gun buff. He had a sporting goods store at one time. He was very good with weapons. And he said, "It looks like a Mauser." And he walked over to Fritz. And Captain Fritz was holding the rifle up in the air. And I was standing next to Weitzman, who was standing next to Fritz. And we weren't any more than 6 or 8 inches from the rifle. And stamped right on the barrel of the rifle was 7.65 Mauser. And that's when Weitzman said, "It is a Mauser," and pointed to the 7.65 Mauser stamp on the barrel.
There's an intonation to that statement that it should mean something.
Well, the shells we found came from a 6.5 Italian rifle.
You mean those three cartridges?
The two don't relate.
Three cartridges that were
found at the southeast corner.
The southeast corner.
Came from a 6.5 Italian carbine.
Mauser German-made rifle with the sniper scope sights that was found on the German-built Mauser with the sniper scope that was used to kill President Kennedy.
7.65 Mauser, German rifle, familiar to those who served in World War II.
Place. It's a 7.65 Mauser German-made army rifle, telescopic sight, and one shell left in the chamber. Three spent shells have been found nearby, and apparently they're hooking this as the murder
super
weapon.
Sniper scope, high-powered Mauser rifle.
The Dallas Sheriff's Department said the rifle had been found in a staircase on the fifth floor of a building near the scene of the assassination. It was a 7.65 Mauser.
A German Mauser, I believe.
There's another word that a Mauser has been found.
Mauser.
Oswald worked in the building where the murder weapon, the German-made Mauser rifle, was
still found in the Mauser with which the assassin was apparently armed.
From Dallas, we have heard that the definite identification has been made of the type of rifle used in the assassination of President Kennedy. It was not a Mauser, as has been reported through most of yesterday and today, but an Italian Mannlicher Carcanto, manufactured in the Italian town of Carcanto.
It is believed that a gap in the motorcade perhaps saved Vice President Johnson from being a target of the assassin today. The gap had opened up in the motorcade just before the assassin's bullets rang out.
Had the rain in Dallas lasted just a few moments more, perhaps as much as an hour more, the presidential car would have had its heavy plastic top on it. Plastic top, certainly heavy enough to deflect a bullet of an assassin, probably to steer it entirely away from the body of the president and the governor of Texas.
Do we know why, in view of the turmoil which has been attributed to Dallas, to the warning which came from Ambassador Stevenson after his visit there, why the plastic bubble top was not on anyway?
I don't think anyone has made an official statement on that, Paul, but I would venture to hazard a guess immediately. It is the reason why is the personality of the late President of the United States, John Kennedy, who never, ever heeded the warnings of his Secret Service men against going into crowds, never, ever obeyed their wishes in staying behind ropes and behind railings where any large crowd was gathered.
So, Hector,
will the nation be all right in the few months ahead?
Oh, I'm not going to predict anything of that. I just say this. The American nation is a people of great common sense, and they are not going to be stampeded or bewildered.
Would you have any advice for the American people at this time?
No, as I said, I know the American people will stand solid, and they will not be stampeded.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
I don't care to go into there, but
I don't know how long the other man
what
works.
What type of establishment
got to the other side of town? Is there anything that can be come up of that? Did he get over by a bus, by a car?
I don't know. We have heard that he was picked up by a Negro in a car.
That is not confirmed.
No, it's not confirmed as far as I know.
Are you looking for the Negro?
We would like to know about him if this is so, we would certainly like to find him.
Chief Curry, could you detail for us what led you to Oswald?
Not exactly, except
that afternoon, after Officer Tippett was killed, they took a suspect into custody. And I was thinking about this man getting away from me.
This was the man that got into the Green Rambler.
The Green Rambler. And I called Captain Fritz at his office and gave him a description of the man I saw get into the Rambler. And he told me, and I quote him, "It sounds like the suspect we have in custody. Come on up and take a look at him." So I went out and got in my unmarked car and drove to the city hall, went directly to Captain Fritz's office. And we went into Captain Fritz's inner office, and the man was sitting in a chair behind a desk. And there was another gentleman. I assumed he was one of Fritz's people because he had the white cowboy hat on, which was the trademark at that time of the Dallas Homicide Bureau. And Fritz turned to me and said, "Is this the man you saw?" I said, "Yes." And it was. It was. So he turned to the suspect and he said, "This man saw you leave." At which time the suspect became a little excited. And he said, "I told you people I did." And Fritz said, "Now take it easy, son," talking to the suspect. He said, "We're just trying to find out what happened." He said, "What about the car?" I didn't say station wagon. He said, "What about the car?" At which time the suspect leaned forward and put both hands up on the desk and said, "That station wagon belongs to Mrs. Payne. Don't try to drag her into this." Then he leaned back and very disgustedly said, "Everybody will know who I am now." Now, this was not a brag. I know it's been blown up to be a brag in the Warren Commission. This was not a brag. This was a man that
you
catch in a building at night, you know, after it's locked. Mm-hmm. This is like somebody who's trying to steal something and you catch him at it.
He was embarrassed about it.
Or disgusted that he had blown his cover or been caught or something. you know, it wasn't a brag.
And from the cities of the United States, where a nation is in almost, I'd say it advisedly, almost uncontrollable shock, it seems. They're weeping on the streets. Schools have to be dismissed. My own school was dismissed because the children were weeping so much they couldn't stay in class. Quite a tragic day, as we all obviously know. Do you want me to relieve you a few minutes here? We might stay on the air, certainly, until all of this is...